psychiatrist oncologist, they promise to come over, and if we have any question clinically, we can ask them, like how many cycles they give and how often, and for how long. I know from our center that at least they'll try for 1 year. And it, again, it depends about the patient. It is the patient's decision.
Thank you.
Sure. Thank you.
Last question from
the yeah, just you keep me on time. So I start looking at this, but you keep the time. Go ahead.
I have a question about the typical polyvoid adenomyomas. How can you explain that the cells, the stromal cells, are positive for the smooth muscle actin and they are negative for desmin? This is the one question. And the other, what is the degree of ETA or intraendometrial neoplasia allowed before you diagnose this lesion as carcinoma?
It's a very unique lesion and very interesting, and it's rare tumor. It's in nodules, and it's presented as polyp. And in this polyp, you see the smooth muscles, and in fact, younger patient. Again, there is no solid, whatever you read the literature, there'll be a case report in elderly women. Sometimes you would see ectopia, and it was a handful of cases that you would see carcinoma. You know, it's the best thing that you have to recognize it, to call it, not to overcall it or undercall it. So you follow whatever is in your slide. If there is ectopia, I would call it with ectopia, typical polyvoid adenomyoma. But you allow for a certain degree of ectopia. Not all the clients have to be atypical. You know what I mean? But in the literature, case report, there was adenocarcinoma arising from a typical polyvoid adenomyoma. So it's not solid that it is 100% benign and it will not progress. No, but remember, these are case reports and they are really eventually rare.
Why the cells are positive for the smooth muscle actin?
There is smooth muscles in the stroma. This is part of it.
The cells are negative for desmin and positive for the smooth muscle actin?
It's the specificity and sensitivity in the immunohistochemistry in each antibody is different. So I never use one. I use either actin or desmin. I use three of them, actin, desmin, caldesmin. If you could, caldesmin is the most sensitive and specific. Okay. Thank you so much. Let's move just to keep the time to the second one.
So, second lecture will be in which you see the serous carcinoma, diagnosis, prognosis, and treatment.
You a brief talk about uterine serous carcinoma, precursor lesion in it, and high-grade endometrial carcinoma in general, the overlapping between micrograde 3, serous carcinoma, clear cell carcinoma, and the uterus. And after the break, I'll be talking about using the word serous, but in the ovary and the borderline. So sometimes you get a little bit overlapping. And it is, for some reason, GYN pathologists really like it. Okay. As I said, and I put this before, the incidence and the etiology of endometrial carcinoma, this is where I'll go quick over what I'll be talking about. The classification, you've heard it, I'll put only one slide. Uterine serous carcinoma. And it is fascinating disease, very aggressive. And quick talk about the molecular, the new classification from the TCGA and the precursor, and I'll end the talk with the differential diagnosis and the overlapping between all the high-grade endometrial carcinoma. It is increasing, as I said in the first one, and this is due to obesity. Overall survival, 82%, which is wonderful. Why? Because they pick up the patient in early stage. It is vaginal bleeding, there is symptoms about it, it's completely different from the ovary. Why in the ovary we have way worse survival? Because the disease has no symptoms. I work in Detroit, and Michigan, Detroit, and we have a lot of African American, and we do a lot of study on endometrial cervical carcinoma because it is increased the incidence in African American. And overall, endometrial carcinoma has a high incidence in African American. This is why I put that. Okay, 17% present in high stage, and patients 17% died of disease. Only 25 to 35% in high grade. This is overall, and I put this in my previous talk. It is increasing. Look at 2003 was only 40,000. Now we are in the almost 15,000 cases in the state. Okay, treatment, as you all know, it is hysterectomy and bilateral salpingooparectomy plus minus nerve dissection. And this is through the years how the surgeon advanced in treating this. Now they do robotic treatment in one incision only. And I borrowed this slide from our GYN oncologist. We work very closely together. Staging, it changed throughout the years, from the 88 till now, and I'm sure you are all familiar with staging endometrial carcinoma. Stage 1A, either no myometrial invasion or inner half. Stage 1B, outer half of the myometrial invasion. 2, cervix, we don't call now stromal or glandular, it's no glandular, so 2 is involving the cervix, and these are the most important ones. Okay, and again, life is not too simple, it's either type 1 or type 2, no, but this is the way it started, and they are two separate diseases. Most of the time, type 1 is the low grade, type 2 is the high grade. And I presented this for you. Well, this was almost 15 years ago. So after 15 years, from a very sophisticated study in the state from the Cancer Genome Atlas, looking at 300 endometrioid type carcinoma and 66 serous using transcriptomic proteomic characteristic of endometrial carcinoma, they reclassify endometrial carcinoma to 4 types: whole ultramutation, MSI hypermutated, copy number low, copy number high. And each one of classes or clusters shows different disease. How did we do as a pathologist from our HNE? Wonderful. We really overlapped. The whole ultramutated, it overlapped with low grade endometrioid carcinoma and the survival rate, I'll show you. So these are the 4 clusters: the whole ultramutated, microsatellite unstable, copy number low, copy number high. And in this, if you focus on this one, I believe I have, look at the, in this Kaplan-Meier, the disease-free interval in this group, they did wonderful. And this is overlapped with endometrioid adenocarcinoma low grade. And if you look at the red curve, it overlapped with serous carcinoma. And this is the worst prognosis that we have. So apparently we are doing wonderful, and I never believed in that the molecular advance will replace us. We work together with the molecular aspects and molecular pathologists, but they will not replace entirely the microscope and the pathologists. And again, this is to re-emphasize on the clusters, the whole hypermutated MSI, the low, the copy number low and the copy number high. This is the serous. This is the low grade, and these are the one in the middle. So what did we learn from this? We learned that serous-like signature is unfavorable, and it is bad disease, and pole signature is highly favorable one. Type 1, as I mentioned, it is low grade most of the time, and it represents the glandular, serous, and the mucinous. How about type 2? Is it straightforward? Is it everyone in this line is type 2? How about fibrograde 3? What is it? Is it in type 1 or type 3, or is it by itself? How about Cleave cell? What about MMMT or undifferentiated carcinoma? This is what I emphasize on in the second part of my talk. What's the risk factor in general in any endometrial carcinoma? It's the grade of the tumor. And of course, the rest of the stage, the depth of myometrial invasion, tumor size, it's not part of the stage, but it is must be written in your report. Because we have so many protocols for treatment and it is a risk factor. So they add them up. So this is a mandatory, and I was surprised that it is not part of the stage. Cervical stromal invasion, of course, vascular invasion also, it is very important risk factors. It is not part of the stage, but it is a must be written in your report. Do you have a synaptic report, like a certain criteria you have to follow in every report? It is some synaptic criteria. It's by CAP that it's mandatory in the state for it. And all of this criteria, it is in there. Okay, so saying the grade, this is why I'm emphasizing on serous carcinoma, because it is by default high grade. So I don't call it high-grade endometrial carcinoma. I call it serous carcinoma, the gynecologist will understand. Or you can say high-grade endometrial carcinoma, comma, serous type. It's very understandable. It is very rare tumor, 10% of all endometrial carcinoma. However, it is 40%, responsible for 40% of all endometrial cancer death. This is why we emphasize a lot on it, because we cannot miss it. First described in the 80s, and the way they picked it up, this gynecologist, pathologist, because of the discrepancy in the way they grow, and they go outside of the uterus. You know, endometrial wave carcinoma type 1, they invade the myometrium. This disease, serous carcinoma, they don't go too deep in the myometrium, they go outside. They have a lot of vascular invasion, and they go to the omentum and the ovary before they go deep in the myometrium. This is the difference between both of them. It is aggressive disease, and I cannot re-emphasize more on this. And 55%, they present as a stage 3 and 4. And the progression-free survival, 65-37 for stage 2 and 3, and 0 for stage 4. One more time to re-emphasize on the fact that they or up to 70% diagnosed with disease outside the uterus. That's really high. So they pick it up in advanced stage. High recurrence rate for stage 1 uterine only up to 31 to 80%. Poor 5-year overall survival. 50 to 80% 5-year overall survival for stage disease. 80 and 90% for all endometrial carcinoma. So, just to re-emphasize on the fact, it is very aggressive tumor. And it is, as I mentioned, it has higher incidence in African American. And this is from a publication from our center that if you look at, this is type 1, the green and the blue, type 2, the red and brown, the red in Caucasian population, the brown is African American, and look at the Kaplan curve, it is the worst in the African American. And it is associated with history of breast cancer, and including like the treatment with tamoxifen therapy. And it is after, I forgot the month, but at least like 3 or 4 years of tamoxifen therapy, some of the patients developed serous carcinoma. So what's the symptoms? It is postmenopausal bleeding, and what's the best way of picking it up? Of course, the endometrial sampling, and sometimes even CA125 will be elevated. Is there any room for CT? It is for treatment planning, not for diagnosing. We published the largest cohort in the literature from multiple institutions, 236 cases of uterine serous carcinoma. We found 55 without myometrial invasion. Out of these cases, 16%, remember these no myometrial invasion, 16%, they were stage 4B. So they went outside of the uterus. Okay, and 40% of these cases, they had the tumor size less than 1 centimeter. So it's very small, but still did very bad. Under the microscope, what do I see? There are so many patterns that I have to recognize. Papillary pattern, glandular pattern, and rarely solid pattern. And the highlight of this tumor, the discordance or the discrepancy between the architecture and the nuclear features. If I say ugly nuclear features, it is here. Okay, but architecture, it can be papillary or glandular. And it resembles ovarian high-grade serous carcinoma. Look at this. We got the slit line. We talk about a lot in high-grade serous carcinoma. Papillary configurations. And a lot of background dirty. It's from the proliferation of the cell proliferate and die. And you get a lot of necrosis. And papillary debris, or nuclear debris, we call it. High power. This is more a glandular pattern. And even within the gland, you see minute papillae projecting through. Another glandular. And if you look at this, there's glands, but they are replaced by high-grade nuclear features and some small papillae. We talk about significant cytologic ectopia. Look at this. We call it popcorn nuclei. Irregular nuclear contour, nucleoli, giant nuclei. I mean, this is a great example of significant cytologic ectopia. This is what you need to call it serous carcinoma. This is what the glands or the epithelium need to be replaced by this cytologic ectopia to call it. Of course, there is mycosis everywhere. And this is a soft finding that you see this is small blue hobnailing. If you look for them, you see them in almost all serous carcinoma. At the molecular level, P53 mutation is the highlight of this tumor. And HER2-neo genes amplification, it is there, and there was a lot of protocol and study about treating this tumor with Herceptin. It didn't work. PIK3CA mutations, again, it is for treatment effect with mTOR inhibitor, and there are more in the, at the research level, but these are at the clinical levels and at so many trials. From the TCGA, this tumor, looking at the mutation, it overlapped with serous ovarian carcinoma and overlapped with basal-like triple-negative breast cancer. It has similar mutations. And it has, and why do I need to know this? The way we look at cancer nowadays, it's not organ specific, it is molecular specific. How many mutation is there? And it helps for trials and it helps for treatment, like the target therapy. If we know a lot about the tumors, we can, you know, like provide or advance in the treatment. Again, talking about overlapping with breast and with the basal line, it so many projects reveal that patients with serous carcinoma have demonstrated germline mutation in BRCA1 in 2% of the non-founder population, so there's an association with hereditary breast and ovarian cancer. And we said this, genetic counseling should be recommended, and we do it in our institution. Immunohistochemistry, do I do immunohistochemistry? Yes. Not all the time, I'll tell you when, in the precursor lesion, not in the straightforward uterine serous carcinoma. Which one I do? P53. And how should it be? It's the way you read P53. It has to be very intense, very, and we call it Christmas tree. Almost all the cells have to be positive, up to 90%. And look at this, do I need P53 on this? No, it is really ugly with nucleoli, and that's psychologic ectopia, and P53 is a Christmas tree. However, it's not almost black and white, right? Well, actually, in this case, it is black and white. Look at this case, it was part of study, and I showed this image in my previous lectures somewhere, so you might see this before. This is serous carcinoma, I had no doubt, and I called it, but it was part of a research I was doing, and I was doing P53. So So first time, the 53 was negative. I'm like, they did some mistake, for sure. So we repeated it, and it was negative again. I'm like, but this is serous carcinoma. And then, probably a few years ago, Dr. Kerman from Mass General, he highlighted that, remember P53, it's mutations, but this mutation can be a nonsense. So it's... So just to tell you about it, that the P53, when it is nonsense mutation, it produces truncated protein. So there is no protein to look at it when we do diagnostic chemistry. So the mutation is there, so you don't call it negative still. So whenever you have a complete dead P53, it is not negative, okay? But you have to differentiate between the wild-type P53 and the mutated P53. Okay, so whenever it is completely negative, it is not negative. The mutation is there. And again, it is HNE, HNE. And this is not working. I'm not a great IT person, but I know the connection is not getting right. I know I'm moving a lot. I don't know if anyone like faced this negative P53 completely, but just it's okay to be aware of it. You don't want to call it negative completely. Moving to the rest of immunohistochemistry, P16 diffusely positive. It's high grade endometrial carcinoma or high grade carcinoma. P53 is positive in almost every high grade malignancy. It is not only related to cervical or HPV. Okay? And of course, it is positive for PR67. It's both retrograde, and it will be positive in that. It expresses peritoneum, we don't use it that much. Positive for P10. P10 is negative in endometrioid carcinoma because we lose it, but not in serous carcinoma. This is a good immunohistochemistry to do. P10, P53, ERPR. ERPR will be negative because it is poorly differentiated, I mean, more advanced disease, very aggressive, very high grade. And in the literature, there is INP3, we do not do it. An example of high grade serous carcinoma, and I put the immunohistochemistry, the first one, P53, P16, PI67, ER. And it's a panel, if you want, you use, again, do not use only one immunohistochemistry, I would use at least a panel of the four of them. Sorry about that. precursor lesion. It's an endometrial intraepithelial carcinoma. See, the wording is so close to endometrial intraepithelial neoplasia that it is the precursor of type 1. So here is the word carcinoma. Do I use only this? No, I always like to put the word serous before it, just in case, because it behaves like serous carcinoma and it is very aggressive, even the precursor lesion, and I'll show you. So always add the word serous, okay? And it is the precursor lesion, and other names used in the literature, carcinoma in situ, I never use this word, it's very misleading. You know, no, it's only in situ, say they won't do anything to the patient, so we do not use it. And it is uterine surface carcinoma. It's being used because sometimes you see it at our surface. So the best way of calling it serous intraepithelial carcinoma. And it is most of the time arise in postmenopausal women, atrophic endometrium, or atrophic polyp as well. P53 can be very helpful in this scenario. And I use both P53 and PI67 at the same time. Look at this, endometrial. Is it atrophic? Yes, look at this. I couldn't put the entire thing in, but look at the gland at the bottom. It's atrophic. These are atrophic glands. But look here. These are not atrophic. But these are not only proliferative, there are more into the glands. I couldn't pick it up, honestly. I'm like, is this serous? But I don't want to overcall it, because it's not a joke to overcall, you know, and call serous carcinoma. Look at P53. It's not picked on the surface, but it was probably the best one. The glands were also terrible, and they had all this significant psychological activity. So most of the time, this lesion can be at the surface, can replace a gland, keep the architecture, but the cytology will be replaced by significant cytologic activity. And there is no confluent, there is no quick reforming, and there is no desmoplastic reaction, there is no invasion. And serous features, you see all the features. You see the marked ectopia, enlarged vesicular nuclei, nucleoli, mitosis, and prominent pupnail morphology as well. So look at this again. Cystic atrophy, and the surface is not right. You got mitosis here, and another mitosis as well here. You do P53, it highlights this malignant cell. So, in the literature, there are so many terminology, and all of them almost the same disease. Uterine serous surface carcinoma. Minimal uterine serous carcinoma with a lesion less than 1 centimeter. No invasion, non-invasive serous carcinoma. And they all share the same morphology, the same molecular biology, and the clinical behavior. And in the literature, why I'm emphasizing on it? Because of the patient. How this lesion behaves. It behaves in a very aggressive fashion, and no difference in all of this in the outcome. So many patients died of disease in this study, and this has been studied for so long. It was a small and different stage system, like 6 recur, 4 died of disease, 2 died of disease. So it has, and even with this small lesion, it has extra uterine disease. And this is our study again. I'm putting it, I'm re-emphasizing on, even with no myometrial invasion, this patient had advanced stage and extra uterine disease. And even with the small lesion, 10% they have outer myometrial invasion, and 10% have lymph node metastasis. Polyp, and look at all of this gland are replaced by this lesion. P53 can be